The following podcast is brought to you by the Jonas Podcasting Network, found exclusively at wrestlingwithjonas.com.
Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host most of the time, Billy. I can only say that now because I've now hosted all but one episode of this show because of episode 100. I am joined on this edition by one of the top referees in the country. There is about five very high-profile referees, and he's definitely one of them. I'm joined by Chris Quinn. Welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me, Billy. Appreciate it.
So you're the second referee I've had on the show. And the first one, Dennis Law from WrestleZone, he's asked a bunch of questions, so we'll definitely get into them at some point. But yeah. The first question is always the same. It's the classic wrestler question on a podcast. How'd you get into pro wrestling? What was the moment that got you hooked?
It's going back, way back. I'm going to probably show my age now. The first time I've ever seen anything with wrestling was my brother got a VHS tape of WrestleMania 6. And that was obviously Hogan Warrior, and put it on. I mean, you were going back, I was a bit maybe 9-10 year old at the time, and I just hooked on it, absolutely hooked on it. And growing up, it was in our house, me and my brother, like two brothers always do, always fight. We always picked sides. He was Warrior, I was Hogan, and then as it progressed into latter years, like he was Brett, I was Sean, but WrestleMania 6 was the first one I seen, and again, we would then source out like a local video store and rent VHS tapes to watch some of the old pay-per-views. And it wasn't until I think around 95 we got Sky, and that's when I first watched my first pay-per-view, which was Survivor Series. And then from there on, it's just been, non-stop, really.
So what was the tape that you went and got?
The tapes went and got back and forth. So his mate gave us WrestleMania 6, and then the ones, there was a Hulk Hogan like collection. It was called Real American or something, and that had like a lot of things for like Wrestling Challenge and Superstars on it. It was all Hogan stuff, and then we got I've never seen WrestleMania 8. We got that one out of the video store. And then a friend who lived two doors up, one of the neighbours, he would record it, the pay-per-views for us. So like I seen like WrestleMania 9 and 10 and stuff like that as well. But the earliest I can remember was 6. And then from then on, right up until when we got Sky in 95, and then watched it from then on.
I was like, there's every story, there's always a guy who records it for you. Because I know my mate recorded it off the Skybox Skybox office. I never seem to speak to people who did the recording and handed the tapes on. It's always, I don't know if they just got fed up of it and just moved on with wrestling. And it's just all us hoping and willing for the VHS tapes to turn up at school the next day to borrow and what have you. I think I've still got a box of them because I'm too great. I don't want to get rid of any of my wrestling stuff. It's really difficult to do. So unfortunately for my wife, they're at my parents in their loft because I don't think I'd get them in here. I've got enough crap in the background already without adding about four or five boxes of DVDs and videotapes but I've kept a VHS player in the loft. It's staying there forever. I don't know if she knows it's still there, but it's there, and it's one of those combi ones, DVD, VHS combis, and I'm like, nah, that's never getting chucked out. That's staying in the house. I'll find a way to get them used. So Hogan was your guy then. That was your first guy.
First one, yeah.
Right about that time, then, of course, it would be big cartoon heroes, the Aquazone. And you had... didn't think I get an Aqua reference at all on a podcast. But so you had those, and then, of course, moved on to 95. That's perfect. Bang into the new gen. So you had all these big characters. And you said Brett and Sean. Was there any other ones that were like, did you love Duke the Dumpster Drozy? Did you... T.L. Hooper? T.L. Hopper, was he your guy? Anyone else?
I mean, like I say, our mate who's a neighbour, he was recording some of the stuff, but when we got Sky in 95, it was Survivor Series, so it was coming into that era. Like, Brett was my brother's guy, Sean was mine, but then watching back some of the stuff previous to that, like in 94, coming into 95, so I didn't really like a lot of the gimmicky ones, like you know, like the Teal Hopper and the Dumpster and Doink the Clown, stuff like that. I remember seeing like Mr. Perfect. I liked him. Diesel. I forgot. I'm trying to think who else had in that time.
Luger.
Luger. I quite like Luger. Razor Ramon. All those kind of ones as well. But again, like seeing it more regularly from 95 onwards is when I really got into it proper, and then, you know, just continued then obviously writing at 96, and then that was it, kept going forward from there.
So I know from my research you're a big fan of one wrestler in particular.
Maybe
a little bit. Your shirt's not giving it away for those who are watching the audio one. So were you watching it? Was it Survivor Series 96? Was it the debut of The Rock?
Yeah, so that was like a year into having Sky, and for the first moment, obviously seeing The Rock, I just thought that's the guy. That's a guy I'm going to get behind, and being a fan of his, obviously, for it's hard when people say who's your favorite all time wrestler, and you know, I would always think like Shawn Michaels was probably the greatest, and then obviously there was the argument again going back with me and my brother. It was like he was an Austin guy, I was a Rock guy, but yeah. For the minute I seen The Rock, and I thought that guy's gold, and just been a huge fan throughout his wrestling career, followed his career, followed his movie career as well. Even some of the, you know, the early horrendous ones that he released, like I can't really say I don't like Tooth Fairy, because I've got a 9-year-old daughter who absolutely loves him more than I do. So she likes all those ones, but then some of the, I've never seen Doom, I won't watch that. Gridiron Gang, that was a bit.
Oh, nice. Thank God! That was the one that I was going to say for a bad Rock film. Gridiron Gang. Yeah. I got that for a birthday present. It's the most boring film I've seen in a long time.
I thought it was like almost like a poor version of Remember the Titans, but it was just not so good. But yeah, I'd say following his career right up until, you know, he left, and then, you know, got into the acting, and then, you know, some horrendous movies that you would think, oh, this is going to be another Hogan scenario with the acting side, but come good now, and then, you know, his returns and that, and I'm still clinging on that he's going to come back and do one more match, hopefully. But
we're all hoping
for that,
Rock,
yeah.
Rock Roman, that's the one, isn't it?
Yeah,
everyone's hoping for. So yeah, the Rock, but kind of same when you try and think your favorite of all time. For those that don't watch wrestling or knew of it, I'd always say Steve Austin, because I know everyone knows Steve Austin. But if I know they're a wrestling fan, it's a weird one. It's Jeff Hardy. It's always Jeff Hardy.
Yeah,
he was that guy for me. That for you, he was the guy I saw, and I was like, "That's the guy. That's my guy. That I'm gonna just support even through the bad stuff. He's still gonna be my guy at the end of it."
The one that was weird, like when you mentioned Austin, is like a very like early memory. Like when I said when we got Sky, and you know, you remember when Raw used to be on like a Friday night, like 10 till 12 on Sky Sports. And I remember, like, me and my brother would sit and watch Raw, and this was around the time, right in the midst of the Attitude Era, and my dad would come in and just like, "Oh, what are you watching?" It's like, "Oh, we're watching the wrestling." And he's like, and he just slate it. It's like, "Oh, that's crap. You know, this is, oh, look," he didn't even touch him there. As soon as Austin came out, he was like, "Oh, I'm going to take notice of this guy." And then he'd then sit and watch it with us, and it was like, "Oh, I like him. I do like him, you know." And it's like him beating up his boss and stuff. And it was that kind of cool way where it was like, my dad instantly was like, "Oh, this is a load of rubbish." Second Austin's there, it's like, you know, I'm going to watch this. I quite enjoy him. So
that's so weird. I like how kind of had the same experiences, even though I started watching around about 99, 2000, so it was a little bit later on. Yeah, it was the same. I got scared by Kane Undertaker, and I was pretty much told, not in these words, but it's just Manny's in suits, so don't worry about it. It's not real. But then my mum would end up just like sitting down watching SmackDown with me, and then she'd be like, "Oh, I don't get it." And then Triple H would come out, and she'd be like, "Oh, well, quite like him."
Yeah.
So, but it's the same. We went to see it live in 2006, and my dad was like, "Oh, I'm taking you because I'm driving. I'm the only one I could drive." And I was 16, so I wasn't driving anyway. But yeah, and seeing he was like, I get why you watch it live. I get that. I don't get the telly bit. Don't understand watching it on the telly. It just looks fake. But when you see it live, it's fine. I get it. But that was his one and done experience watching it live. You'll come to the W3L, but that's about.
Yeah.
bit different. So yeah, The Rock was your guy. Yeah, loved The Rock, and we moved on to years later. Then you started training at GPWA. So how did you decide to go, right, I'm going to actually give this a go?
So at the time, I think I was about 34. So it was about 5-6 years ago. Yeah. I used to do stand-up comedy for a good 5 years, and I love, you know, the art of performing and, you know, crowd work and loads of stuff. And done, you know, a number of shows at the Stand, done shows at the Fringe, the Glasgow Comedy Festival and stuff. And it was that way where I think my heart just kind of fell out of it towards the tail end, and I kind of didn't feel like I was progressing and going anywhere. And I remember seeing at the time, I think it was, I didn't really know a lot about the indie stuff, and it was a couple of mates who were through for Glasgow kind of way, and they took me to an ICW show in Glasgow and also a BCW show in Kilmarnock, and again just got right into the indie stuff. And then I think it was there I'd maybe seen like an advert for the GPWA, or it might have been on Facebook or something. And it was just that kind of way where I'd wrapped up the comedy and I thought, right, this is me. I'm finishing up with this. I'm not going to keep going with this anymore. And I thought, I want to do something. And it was just that kind of weird way where it's like, well, do you know what? It's now or never. I've got to give it a try. And more so, like, because I was always my daughter, which is 9 now, so she was getting a wee bit older. And I always wanted to do something that she could maybe come and see me, and couldn't really do that with the stand-up stuff. So I thought, well, you know, wrestling's always something I've loved, and it's kind of cool to say, well, I'm going to give that a go and see if it could become anything. But I wasn't naive enough to think, well, I'm 35 now, so it's really like, this is it. You know, I'm not 21. So so just went along, signed up for their induction course, and it was like an 8-week course. And just, you get taught the basic, you know, fundamentals of wrestling, you know, the basic moves. And you learn very quickly how much it does hurt. And when it's the one thing when you get all those really ignorant people that will say wrestling's fake, it's like, it's not fake. There's nothing fake about it. And yeah, just learning that was something that I just thought, I'm going to give this a go and see where it went.
Just to back up a little bit then, of course, to stand-up comedy, which I do have in my notes here. My 10 line of notes. What was your kind of comedy style then? Was it realism? Was it just classic jokes? What was your kind of thing?
Kind of observational. A lot of things taken from my personal experience. A lot of the things I like to do would be focusing on, like, you know, relationships, you know, couples. My kind of outlook was like, if someone my mom and dad's age came, and someone my friends came, and couples, you know, I would make jokes about, like, you know, what the missus would do, or, you know, what would drive her nuts that I would do, and vice versa, and things that anyone could relate to. And then becoming a father, you know, the kind of the joys of having kids, and, you know, all things that could be funny within that. And again, a lot of things that people could relate to, no matter if you were, like I say, 25, 30, 35, 40, 50, 60, whatever. And then just, you know, some of the kind of obvious observational things, like if there was something, you know, particular in the news, you could, you know, kind of make jokes around. I remember around the time I made a load of jokes about when there was that horse meat scandal and the burgers and all things like that. And just, again, picking wee things and finding that. But again, I think I got out at the right time, because I kind of feel now that it must be, like, when I, you know, guys that I'm still friends with in the business and that, it must be so hard, because, you know, everyone's offended at everything nowadays. So I think it must be so tough to even try and find that balance, because you're never going to please everybody with comedy. And comedy is subjective, but it is the sort of thing where at the time I enjoyed it, but I just didn't, my heart kind of fell out of it. I just didn't really, maybe it was laughing, should we say that, you know? It was that kind of way.
Was it, I mean, because the comedy circuit and what have you, seen in Edinburgh and the Stand and what have you, were you aware of like Billy Kirkwood doing ICW commentary and stuff like that? Was that, did you ever cross paths at all and be able to discuss wrestling at all?
We never discussed wrestling. It was actually weird because I'd actually gigged with Billy once. Because so when I'd done the stand, it was always they're on a night called Red Raw, which is like a new act night, and you'd maybe go along and you get like 5 minutes, and then you can then work up to 10 minutes and stuff. And it was basically for like, you know, complete beginners, people who'd maybe been doing it, you know, 6 months, a year, 2 years, and then you'd get the occasion where, you know, you get somebody like a Kevin Bridges or someone coming down to try out, you know, material for a tour. And there was a gig I done in Glasgow stand, and Billy was a compere that night. And I think I'd seen a bit of a show of Billy's once before, but I wasn't like aware that, you know, the connection with ICW that he done. And then I think it was only after getting to know Billy through ICW, and then I think I put something on my Instagram around the time when, you know, with the lockdown and the like, pandemic stuff, and it was all to do with like how people were trying to get, you know, the art saved and stuff. And I think I shared a picture of me doing a gig at the stand, just saying, you know, it was something to do with that. And Billy commented like, wait, how have I missed this? And then it was like, I done a gig with you once, and then we came, and he's like, oh, but so we did, I, and then kind of remembered that. But no, we never really crossed paths in regards to wrestling or even chatted with wrestling, because at that time I wasn't fully aware of the independent scene in Scotland or elsewhere.
Well, though, it seems to be like one of those secrets, and as soon as you see one show, this whole world opens up, and you, it's like as soon as you, for yourself, mm-hmm. you would have seen like Lionheart and Jack Jester and what have you in that ICW or that BCW show, and then mm-hmm. next second you'll be standing in front of them as they're telling you to do whatever in GPWA, and then
yeah.
and then you see that, then you see posters everywhere, and your Facebook algorithm starts picking. I don't know.
That was it.
Another promotion that's local. I've mentioned W3L, so W3L, mm-hmm. I'll mention them, and it just becomes a whole, it's a weird world once you enter mm-hmm. it. I mean, you've entered it far further than I have, but it's still a weird world nonetheless. So GPWA then, you did the 8-week induction, and like I say, for those that want to know a little bit more, the Callum stuck out a draw, because it was really nice companion piece I put with this.
Mm-hmm.
But that 8 weeks, was it niggling injuries that you got that kind of?
Yeah, I had a kind of problem with my knee and my groin and stuff, and it was just, I didn't feel like I was getting, like, I don't think I could do as much as I felt I possibly could do, and tried just pushing through it, but it was still, the niggle was there. And then obviously they've got a selection process of who makes it onto the next stage. And unfortunately, I didn't get through to the next stage. But I had the sole purpose of going back there, because it was like, you know, they said that you can reapply and try it again. And I knew myself, it was just in my own things, it was just a like little niggles and stuff that wasn't making me, like, you know, especially with the knee and the groin, that it was like, you know, try to do proper bumps, try to, you know, get running and stuff. It was holding me back. So from there, it was, I think it was August, it was an 8-week induction, and it was like August to the end of September. And I remember not getting through, and then there was another January intake. And I think I'd said that I was going to come back to that. But then I decided, like, when I heard about Reckless, and that was like a wee bit closer to home. So that was when, I went along. I think it was a mate of mine had he'd seen a Reckless show in I think it was Clubman Town Hall or somewhere, and he mentioned, he goes, have you heard of this company Reckless Intent? And I was like, no, I've never heard it. Again, you know, I just knew ICW, I knew BCW, and didn't really know a lot of the kind of, like you said, the vast amount of other indie promotions that there is. And then it was to the tail end, I think it might even been Boxing Day or the 27th or something, and it was like, just, you know, messaged the page, invited me along at the training class, went along, and again, gasped my experience, what I had, the trainers there, and obviously explained about the GPWA thing, and then went through, you know, again, more of the basics, and then found it more, and then just got a good feel for it. And again, you know, at the time, it was more a financial thing. It was Livingston, so it was closer to me than obviously traveling back and forth to Glasgow. And then just, you know, messaged GPWA and said, you know, I found another school that I'm going to give it a go, thank them for, you know, all their time and whatnot. Because, again, I still, you know, getting to train with the guys like, say, Lionheart and Jester and BT and everyone, it was, for seeing them on shows and, you know, doing that and then being training with them, it was quite different to do. But then when I found Reckless, it was just something that I felt more comfortable there. And then, yeah, I started training there.
I don't know what the because Reckless didn't really, well, I think they do now, but they didn't really have an induction stage at that point. It was more come and if you're good enough, keep coming and we'll tell you if you're any kind of thing. It was kind of whereas GPWA, even though you're training with the elite in Scottish wrestling, these are the like the biggest names, or at least those that have got a good track record, plenty of accomplishments, promotions, and I've trained in places like they've done WWE tryouts and what have you. So that's your kind of, it's a bit more pressure, I suppose, when you're in front of those guys. Whereas Reckless, even though they've got guys like, they would have had Michael Chase. Because I remember him as Mikey as well when I started. All right. So even though he did tryouts with WWE as well, it seemed there's a little bit less of a, like, strict structure of you've got 8 weeks. If you're not good enough, then you could try again next time. Whereas you can kind of come and go with Reckless a little bit more. But yeah, is that a little bit better for you?
In a way, yeah. I mean, because like the 8 weeks is the very basics. It's just, it's, you know, to really find out and let you see what it takes to, you know, on the basics. Like I said, a bump in, you know, feeding, you know, cardio. It's only, that's to really let you see the initial intake of what the absolute basics are. It's when you get past that, that's when you then go more into proper wrestling training. I mean, the GPWA stuff was a great insight to see exactly how everything really starts. Like I say, from bumping, from, you know, running ropes to taking buckles to, you know, learning how to properly lock up and stuff. But you do find, I think there's a lot of people maybe going thinking, oh, I can do this, this is easy, this is, you know, and then you get a very quick shock to the system that it's like, this isn't as easy as you think it would be. So going, knowing what to expect, and even going into Reckless, there wasn't like an 8 week induction thing to do now, but it was very much, right, let's see what you can do. Can you bump? What have you done? Tell us what you've done. Show us what you've done. And then we'll then just work on that. And then it was just like then progressing into more, you know, sequences and moves and stuff like that as well.
Very random sidebar when it comes to the wrestling, but because you're a bit older, you would have had a million times been told that, oh, DDP started late, Dave Batista started late, which would have happened quite a lot. Was there any, did you have any thought in your mind of a wrestling name, because you would have had all that years watching it but not actually getting to do it? Did you have a idea of a character? Was it The Rock-esque? Did you have a name for yourself?
There wasn't so much a, not like Rock-esque. I didn't want to kind of rip that off. I was big into, I still am big into Marvel and stuff. And at the time, I think the Logan movie had came out with Wolverine and everyone. And I kind of liked that name, Logan. So that it was going to be Logan something. And then when I first started refereeing, I had Logan as my name. But then I just kind of thought, no, I need to drop that and change it. So it was a kind of way where I was trying to, like, people at Reckless like to kind of have a lot of characters and character kind of styles. And I was finding it quite hard to try and find what kind of character would I have. You know, everyone wants to be the cool, you know, heel, but not everyone can be the cool heel sort of thing. Or you kind of have a whole show full of cool heels. But when we're talking about, like, you know, using what inspirations you can have, whether it be things like comic book movies, you know, things that might be interested in and draw inspiration from that. And it was going to be Logan something or something Logan. I think it was Logan. I don't know if it was going to be Logan Quinn. It was going to be Logan something else. And then when I started refereeing, I started as Logan Quinn. But then I just thought, nah, I need to drop that and just be myself.
I'm glad you said that, because I was having like a Mandela effect thing when I was doing your graphic and everything, and I was looking at it going, that doesn't look right. I'm sure it wasn't always Chris Quinn. And there was like, I think it was Logan something. It was Logan. And as soon as, if anyone's watching the video, we saw me go, because that was it. I was like, I knew it was Logan something. It was Logan Quinn when you started. Thank God. That's settled my brain for the day, because I spent all day going, is that right? Chris Quinn doesn't look right when I've written it down. It should be something else, but good. That's fine. Yeah, big Marvel fan in this house, in this wee room. Any particular favorite films? I don't want to ask a ranking, because there's like 29 movies and TV shows in the MCU particularly, and that's not even thinking about Fox mergers. But any particular favorite Marvel characters? Is it Wolverine?
Wolverine was a big one, but Iron Man was always my top favourite, and obviously all the Avengers stuff. And I've been fortunate enough with my wee girl who absolutely loves it. You know, she's a wee girly girl, and I remember the first time where she said to me, when she was at mine, I think it was like a Thursday night, and she said, can we watch Avengers Infinity War? I was like, yes, absolutely. You know, so we sat and I thought, you know, is she going to sit through like, you know, a 2.5 hour film? And she did and loved it. And it came to the end, and obviously Infinity War ended. And it's like, you know, Endgame's next. And she's like, can we watch that? I was like, no, it's 9:30 at night. You need to get to your bed. Can we watch it on Sunday? Aye, okay. So we've done it wrong in the sense that like watching it with her, but we watched Infinity War, then Endgame. And then we went back and then watched them all, you know, in order. But yeah, I love all that kind of stuff with the MCU, and you know, even now, like our wee thing that we've got is kind of like superheroes, and she's right in the Flash and stuff as well on the DC side, and you know, the CW TV series stuff, and looking forward to the movies and that coming up next year. And just anytime I see anything that's, you know, Marvel or DC related movies, Disney Plus series stuff, I'm always like, you know, she's got a phone now, so I'll text her a wee screenshot, oh, this is coming up soon and that, and it's just, it's quite cool having that wee thing with her, and I'll be able to share that with her as well.
I don't have a little girl. I've got a wife, but it's very, very similar when it came to, she turned around one day and went, you know what, I kind of fancy watching Captain America. And I was like, well, Blu-ray, DVD, streaming, what would you like to watch it on? I have everything, just you pick. But Disney Plus is the best thing when it's come to that.
The sole reason I got it was when I seen, because when I started getting her into it, and I think we watched that Avengers one on DVD, Infinity War, and I had Endgame as well. And then I think it was that way where you'd always find some on like Netflix or Amazon, but you'd never get every single one. There's always, I think, there was certain ones, I think like Civil War you could never find, or you had to rent it or pay for it. And then as soon as I heard Disney Plus was getting launched, and it's like, oh, and the whole Marvel is on that, I was like, right, just for that. That's what I'm getting it for. And watched it on that.
Except Hulk, but you don't need Hulk.
My
only like disappointment is Spider-Man's my favourite. So you have to do a little bit more searching. It's on Netflix, and only some of them are. So I watched this Spider-Man today, the first one, Tobey Maguire, and I was watching it going, we're spoilt nowadays with CGI and everything, because I was watching it going, oh, this is a bit rough.
Yeah.
That glider definitely has been put on top of something else, because that doesn't look right at all. But Marvel films, always a good topic. We can make this a Marvel podcast, but we've got other things to speak about, so we'll move on. So Logan Quinn started, wasn't a referee at first though. I've got noted down that we went to Reckless, you're doing your training, doing odd bits and pieces here, crew, and you got a little bit of ring announcing. What was it like getting behind a microphone again, even though it was just ring announcing?
It was good. From my background with the stand-up, you know, the guys at Reckless said to me, like, are you comfortable doing it? I was like, well, yeah, no, I've done plenty stand-up, and it's hard making people laugh, you know, so it wasn't really that kind of nervous way. It was more just learning, obviously, certain things that you had to say, and not try to... I think the first couple of things I've done it off cue cards, just so I got things right, but then you kind of got familiar weight guys, you know, entrances, weights, all that kind of stuff, names, nicknames. And it was good. It was good just to kind of be on shows. That was the kind of way to kind of be being part of the business, but to try and do something. And again, it was like still building through the training, where it was like, you know, you would pay and dues, essentially. You know, you would do ring crew, you do security, you would do maybe ring announcing, while all still training, just to kind of, you know, hopefully get an opportunity. But I think it was just something that the guys there seen that had obviously the experience of talking in front of a crowd, talking on the microphone, and being comfortable with it as well. So it was good fun.
And I mean, wrestling crowds are a lot more forgiving than comedy crowds. You can just kind of ask them to repeat something in, and the majority of the time they'll just do it back unless they proper don't like you.
Yeah. It's only when you see the likes of someone like Simon Cassidy, who's just, to me, fantastic at doing it. He's up there, like, you know, when you, anytime you think of ring announcers, whether it be for wrestling or boxing stuff, you've got like your Michael Buffers and Bruce Buffers and, you know, Howard Finkels, and like Simon Cassidy, I think is fantastic. And Kwaku as well, who we've got at Reckless, he's brilliant as well. Love working with Kwaku. He's just, he's a guy that, you know, so funny, but just so energetic as well. It's just to everyone brings something to a show, and guys like that, you know, Simon, Kwaku, who can just, they're the ring announcers, but they're a massive part of the shows as well, which is just, it's what you need. You need personality. That's what it is.
Exactly. I mean, at the end of the day, they're the for lack of a better term, they're the compere for the show. They're the ones that are introducing everyone in. They're getting the crowd all hyped up before the wrestlers come out. Likes of like you said, you mentioned Simon and Kwaku, Stevie Wizard, W3L, and also Martin Clunas up in WrestleZone. They've got a really good way of just getting the crowd hyped. And then even if this is their first show, they don't know any of the wrestlers' names, you're ready just to see some action happen and come out. And yeah, it's one of those unsung jobs that, it, I mean, for you, you were just comfortable on a mic and it's you're well up for it, but it's very easy for a trainee that goes, I just want to wrestle, just to kind of just not do it, just be like, oh, I'm stuck, I'm just doing this as a job to help out. Whereas from what I've understood from, again, listening to Tuck of the Draw and how we're speaking just now, if you're given a job, you're doing it to your highest, best of your ability, because it's an opportunity at the end of the day as well. So when it came to, so at this point you're still training, so still there was still plans to be Logan Quinn the wrestler, but it wasn't to be. You end up refereeing just kind of out of the blue with little preparation. So again, like I said, companion piece, Tuck of the Draw, but we'll speak about the same stuff here because it's all the same subject. When you were told that you were going to be refereeing, initial thoughts, do you think, did you have time to do a little bit of research and get some bits and pieces? what was it like?
So what happened was, again, like on Tuck of the Draw, you can hear more about it, but I came to the point with the training where, again, a few niggle injuries, and, you know, we mentioned earlier the whole DDP Batista type of thing, but I wasn't in the best of shape. I wasn't really looking after myself. Fitness wasn't the best. And I'd done like my rotator, and it was just like, I couldn't keep up with the guys as such, you know, and I kind of felt I was holding them back. So I kind of made the decision, and I spoke to the guys at, like, Mikey and the guys at Reckless, that I don't think this is for me in regards to actively pursuing a wrestler role, because it just wasn't working, and I couldn't, you know, get injury after injury after injury. And it is a business where that's going to happen, but I just kind of felt this isn't working. And they were brilliant with me. They liked my attitude, my ethic, my work ethic, and they said, look, you know, there's always something for somebody in wrestling. You know, if you want to be part of it, you maybe just need to find your opportunity, find your spot as such. So through that was, I think, maybe, I want to say, mid 2017, maybe the summer 2017, and that's when I made that decision. And then the initial plan was going to be still have the Logan Quinn character, but doing it as like a like still doing some ring announcing and stuff, but in doing it maybe as like a manager kind of role, so like an on-show kind of manager or something, like leading a stable or something. And then it came to the, when was it, 2017 in September, and it was a show, and again, just, you know, we're still going along the shows, helping out ring crew. Stevie was obviously a ring announcer, but whenever he couldn't do it, I'd fill in, you know, working security and just doing, waiting for that opportunity to come up, which I thought, you know, there'll be some kind of storyline or some kind of thing that will happen with this manager role. And it was a show in September, and Marston, who is on Reckless, he goes by Yannick Novak, he's he was a referee, so he was refereeing a lot of the Reckless shows. And it was literally maybe, so I was there, done ring crew, and I think, you know, your usual, your black trousers, your black shirt, running security. And it was literally about maybe, I don't know, 20 minutes before first bell, and Marston was ill, and he was like, I think, thrown up, and he just couldn't go out. And the guy said to me, listen, we need a referee, can you referee? So instantly I was like, panicked, you know, I was like, oh, you know, oh my god, right, okay, wait, right. So took me aside and says, look, you know, you've watched wrestling all your life, you know it, just go out and have fun. So there was literally no preparation. It was literally, there's a referee shirt, had my black trousers and trainers on, and go out and referee this show. And that's what the one thing they said to me in the very beginning was, like, go and just, you can count to three, you know, go and have fun, go and enjoy it. And the nerves and anxiety was like through the roof, just absolutely panicking about, you know, and especially as well because, and a wee kind of sidebar is like, so the main event of that show was Grado and I think it was Divers. I think it was Grado and Divers. And again, I'd seen Grado at ICW, one of the first shows that I'd went to at the Garage. And this was around the time of, you know, when I first seen him, he was really starting to kind of get like massive, you know, attention. And by this point, like, you know, you put Grado on the card and, you know, sell out show. So I was absolutely panicking, thinking, right, I knew he was on the show, and it's like, you know, it's cool to be on a show where Grado's on, but then to then be thrust into it, it's like, right, well, you're now going to be in the ring refereeing his match. And I remember coming through, it was the end of the first half of the show, the interval, and I came through the curtain. And they said to me, you know, good job, you're done well, just keep it going. So, and even at this day, I still do a thing, but I'll go and speak to the guys before matches and just find out, you know, if they need anything, if there's any, like, you know, spots with an referee or anything. So I went over to Grado and just said to him, you know, first time ever refereeing tonight, do you need anything? He's like, no, it'll be basic. This is the finish, blah, blah, blah. And that was fine. Went out, done the match. It was fine. Came back through, got a great reception, and I remember, like, Grado was maybe sitting, I don't know, maybe 10 yards, 20 yards away, and it was like, I thought everything had went fine, and he looked over, he went, ref, come here. And I'm like, oh no, what have I done? What have I done? Have I screwed this up? And I went over, and he just said to me, he went, is that the first time you said it was the first time refereeing? I was like, yeah. He said, brilliant, well done a really good job. And I was like, oh, thanks very much. And, you know, coming for somebody like him, that was huge. And then that's what they said to me at Reckless. He goes, I think we've found your position in the wrestling business. And
I love hearing Grado stories. Grado seems to be the guy, even though he's awful at replying to emails, but he comes across as a guy, no ego. He's one of the biggest wrestlers in Scotland. Easily, he's been in TNA and or Impact and what have you, and yeah, you always hear stories like that where he's just the most soundest of guys.
He's absolutely brilliant, and it's the fact is where the more I got to work with him, and he was just always very complimentary about my work and just saying things like, you know, you're a really good ref. But to hear that on the first night, where he obviously knew. You know, I mean, that could have been anything. You know, he didn't have to say that. You know, it's like, you know, I was just a guy on a show refereeing. But the fact is, like, he actually took the time to say to me, you know, that was your first night. You've done well, done a good job. And that like come to like say someone like him to, you know, his stature and his level he's at, you know, was huge. So it was really it was cool to hear that to him.
Right, we'll stop at the refereeing bit. I'm going back to the manager bit because I'm all curious about that. So right about the time you're in, I think it was Darren T. Goss would have been doing his Goss Dynasty stuff around about then. So, but even then, that would probably have been the only manager, maybe a couple other like sidekicks or what have you. Was there any? Did you get any pitches, or were you pitching to manage anyone in particular?
There was nothing was ever pitched, and like that opportunity never ever came. It was just something that was mentioned that, you know, we could maybe do this for you, or, you know, we could maybe look at see if something happens. And obviously at the time, I think I was doing security, and that's when the whole Goss Dynasty was in effect. And again, there was never anything that I was just waiting really for them to say, right, you know, we're going to maybe put these guys together and maybe put you with them, or we'll. I think I'd mentioned a couple of times where I think it was even something like obviously Goss had the Goss Dynasty, and that was the kind of the main heel faction in the company. So that, in a sense, that role was kind of taken. But again, I had just kind of ideas of thinking, right, could I be... I was watching a lot of stuff, watching a lot of managers, like, say, like Bobby Heenan and Paul Heyman and guys like that. But again, it's very hard when you see... Like, you don't really get a lot of face managers now that I can even think, even like in a lot of indie stuff. It seems to be that the manager or a valet is always like in the heel work. But no, there was never anything that was ever pitched. And it was just, I think, like waiting for an opportunity or waiting to see... what could we do if something were to come up, but no, it never ever materialised anything.
So back to refereeing then, of course, Lewis Young, he did send a question saying, how did you get into refereeing? We're on that subject now, so that's great, it's handy. So night one, you've refereed main event with Grado, you know, no pressure, and you've got a good bit of feedback. What was your next step then? Was it going home and just going, right, I need to find classic matches and watch what the referee's doing? Did you get your Rock collection out, your Hulk Hogan collection out? And it was just going, right, I need to watch Earl Hebner, I need to watch Mick Kyoto.
Yeah.
Was that your plan from that point forward?
It was pretty much where it was like getting to do that on the show, and then having the guy say to me, you know, I think we've found your place in the wrestling business. And then it was like knowing, right, well, this is, I'm going to, like you said, I'm going to give it my all. This is what I want to do. And I had fun. That was the main thing. Like when I was doing it on the show, nerves aside, was having fun. So then, yeah, it was a sort of thing where I would go and, I mean, I don't watch a lot now. I catch up on WWE stuff now. Back then I was still watching, you know, Raw and SmackDown and things, but after that, I kind of then started then paying attention to the referees. So I'd watch, you know, their movement, their communication, their ring positioning, and just try to pick up any wee tips that I could then, you know, put into play for myself. And then I think no long after that was, so it was what with Reckless, and then I can't remember, I think it was... we've done Scott Rennick's tribute show. I think that was in the, you know, October or November. And I remember, I think it was Brian Lang was on that. He'd done that show. And again, I'd only been doing it, you know, I think I'd done the October show. Then it was Scott. So I'd literally done two shows as a ref. And then spoke with Brian, and he gave me a couple of bits, you know, tips and stuff. But it wasn't until, I think, towards the January when I then got to Discovery, that's when I started working with like say Thomas Cairns and John McLaughlin, and really just picking their brains for a lot of advice, feedback and stuff. But then also still attending training, but then it was like I would still do the, you know, the cardio drills and the fitness stuff and ring awareness stuff. But then when it came to us doing, you know, match practice, well, we've now got a referee that can practice as well as such, so we're still doing that right through, and still do even now.
It was a fairly brave choice to go to refereeing when you've noted that you had knee injuries and rotator cuff injuries, yes. Which is two of the more important things you require for your limbs when it comes to refereeing. I did hear on the tug of the draw that knee pads was one of the first bits that you realised you needed following your debut.
But that was the thing, because I'd made the decision where I was no longer going to wrestle. And again, like, you know, was never at a level. You know, they always say that old saying where, you know, you go to shows, always take your gear with you. You never know. But when I came to that point where I didn't have gear. I had, like, you know, a pair of knee pads and a pair of boots. That was it. So I was never ever the type, because I was a trainee, you know, I was never taking gear to shows and stuff. And then literally getting thrust into it, it was a case of, I'm in my black kind of trousers and trainers, I've been handed a referee shirt, and then when that first time going down for a count, you know, hard down on the knees, it was just like, oh my god, it was you know, felt it the next day, and then it was like, yeah, invest a good pair of knee pads because you'll need them, and even perfecting that referee slide thing, you're still coming down on a knee as such, but yeah, the knee pads, and again, it's just one of these kind of tricks that nobody knows, like the referees wear knee pads, so.
I know. I was surprised. I only learned that during my chat with Dennis from Wrestling Referee. It's like, oh, I didn't know that. Even though I've seen a ring getting built, and I'm looking at it going, I'm not going to slam my knees down on that any more than I have to if I was in that. Even though there's a little bit of a cushion, but it's only about like that.
Yeah.
And then it's wood. And then slamming your hand on it for, and it's loud, even though it does. You get the wee sound because of the little space, but no, it's a bit more hard work than people may think being a referee. The body.
Yeah, that's what people think. It's like, you know, like I remember Stephen who done the Tuck of the Draw podcast. He said your hand and arm must be killing you after a show, and you kind of get used to it. I mean, there is times where like you can, like anything, you hit it the wrong way and you might feel your wrist kind of go away, but you're like, oh, but again, it's, you know, practice and. You do get used to it. You learn your own wee techniques, know how to do certain ways. I mean, some guys do the big over the arm swing count. Some guys are more slamming. Some people are more up and down. It's just you find your own way. As long as you're making it, you know, big enough for everyone to kind of see and hear as well. I've seen some guys who don't even count. They'll like I verbally count when I'll shout out the numbers, but. Some referees I've seen on, I can't remember what it was, I remember seeing, I think, something, an indie something, they were just hitting the mat. And again, I used to always think that when you go down, sometimes that can make that bump, and that could maybe confuse somebody. Is like, is that being a one? And then is that one, you know, so, yeah, just, you learn your own tricks and your own wee things to do.
So I'm just going to get into Dennis's questions and then we'll kind of dip in and out of them because there's ones that I want to get to. But the first one is pretty much how we're getting what we've been discussing already. Mm-hmm. What's the one bit of advice about refereeing that you've been given that has stuck with you, other than get knee pads?
Other than get knee pads? Probably. So when I first obviously started and I'm trying to think. Knowing when I first started, and obviously, you know, working with a lot of guys who've been doing it a long time, I never wanted to try and be someone who thinks he knows everything. So I would always take it upon myself to speak to all the guys beforehand. And like I say, just, you know, always being that way, you know, showing respect and you know, introduce yourself, everyone shake hands and stuff. But in matches, it was just, you know, I was just kind of like, going along with things in that way. So I think one of the best bits of advice I've got was to kind of be more authoritative in the ring, actually show that the referee is a presence. But one of the best compliments I got was I was told that, you know, when I'm there, but it's like I'm invisible, and that's what you want from a ref, but to also be more authoritative and not move about as much. That was one thing I was told very early on, not to move about. And again, when the camera or the crowd are focusing on something, if you've got a referee that's constantly, you know, moving about, you've got to get out of the way of things and try and stay in position for certain spots and certain moves and that, but trying not to move as much and just really keep an eye on the action and not try and take the attention of anyone watching on camera or in the crowd itself to be on you, because the action's all about the guys in the ring. So I'd say the best ones that's really stuck with me is just, you know, and even guys now I tell, like at Reckless, who are training at ref, like just to try and not move about as much, because sometimes with the rings as well, they can rattle, and if there's too many footsteps, it can for crowds as well, it can catch attention, and that's the last thing you want, because it's taken away from what's actually meant to be going on, which is the guys in the ring.
And of course, working with cameras as well, you kind of try and be mindful of not moving, mm-hmm. because for the same reason, not just for a crowd watching and listening and hearing all the creaks and that, but those watching. Mm-hmm. When I was listening to that, you said you've got three sides of the ring. That is your sides that you have to work from. Yeah. And the fourth one is the front of the stage. So
that was another good one, which working towards a hard cam. When I first started, obviously refereeing Reckless, we didn't use a camera, and then I think they didn't use a hard cam. They used cameras and guys going about handheld, but they didn't use a hard cam. So I was literally going round that ring, you know, just try to stay out of the way, try to be in position and stuff. And then when I first got to Discovery, and that was one of the biggest mistakes I made refereeing, was cutting across that hard cam all the time. And it was just like, when I watched it back, I thought, oh God, I can see it now. And that's what they said, try not to go in front of the hard cam. And I'm like, where's the hard cam? All right, okay. And then learning, you know, about your three sides. And the general rule of thumb is kind of like, if the hard cam is like on crowd side, and it's, you know, you'd have your back, say, to the stage, and your area is just like back to the stage and those three sides, and never really kind of cross. There will be obviously the occasion where, depending on the positioning for pins and certain things, you have to go in a bit. But again, general rule is to kind of stay in that area.
See that you've picked up these. I mean, the next one from Dennis was biggest mistake you've done while refereeing, which is you've kind of covered that. But is there any other moments that you've fast counted by mistake? Or the person hasn't kicked out and you've just had to go by, well, I count three. No. If you don't kick out, then that's not my issue from that point.
It's a weird one, because it's like you're always kind of taught to call it as you see it, and it is, as much as like you kind of know like what the finish is going to be and you know how you're going to get to that. I've been quite fortunate that that's never really happened. Again, the certain wee things where I think there was a Discovery show where somebody got a kind of bloody nose. And I just kind of like got on with it, and I was told after, like, you should have kind of just checked he was okay. And again, you learn through experience, and you learn as you go on more and more what, you know, certain wee instances, like things, because obviously if something was to happen to somebody in the ring, well, you're the closest one there. So you've got to kind of be, you know, alert on the ball, so to speak, as with anything that could potentially happen in the ring. So, no, there's never ever been, not I can remember anyway, but I think, no, there's never been the occasion where there's been like a fast, like a three that's not meant to be. But again, it is that kind of rule we're kind of taught that if that wrestler doesn't kick out, well, that's on them. You know, we're told to call it as you see it, because I think it would look, and I've discussed this with Sean McLaughlin, that if a referee was to hit, so if I knew the finish was not going to be a certain way and that guy's not kicking out and I've hit one, two, why am I stopping if he's not kicking out? And it just makes it look stupid. So the onus really is on the guys to kick out. And again, that's one of the, like, another bit of advice is always try and be present at the shoulders, because when you've got those, like, you know, two and three quarter kickouts where the guys might be watching for you just about to hit and then kick out the last second, but if they're down, you have to call it as you see it. And it's always been a strange one where I've always just kind of thought, you know, please kick out. I know you've got to kick out, so please just do it. I didn't want to have to hit this and then think, oh, I screwed the match up. But again, it's like, well, normally this is on you to kick out, so just call it as you see it.
Yeah, it's either the match looks right, but the finish is wrong, or you hesitate in that last count and then the match looks wrong. So yeah. out of the two, you'd rather have the match look right and then the finish can be fixed later with another match or something else. But yeah, as long as the match looks okay, then that's fine. Mm-hmm. Is there any, when you go back now watching wrestling, now that you've of course been a referee and what have you, is there any matches like we see guest referees and that? The one that comes to mind is Mick Foley WrestleMania 17, where you can watch back and now you're watching the referee and going, oh no, you should, because Mick had a very good way of cutting across that hard cam and of course blocking the big coast to coast at the end of the match. So is there any matches that you go back and now you've got a little bit more of a like a referee critical brain watching them more than the actual match itself?
I think I'm more drawn to watching the refs just to kind of even see what they're doing. I do watch a lot like I kind of pick up on certain things, and you'll see like some guys that want, you know, it to be about them, and that's not what it should be. I'm kind of keeping up to date with WWE, but I couldn't tell you the last time I watched a full Raw or SmackDown. I kind of almost catch up on like Facebook or YouTube or stuff like that. I'm loving the Roman Reigns stuff, but watching full episodes, I don't. AEW, I do watch a lot of that because I really like their product, and obviously seeing their referees. There's one referee. Bald headed guy, I can't remember his name, but he's very animated when he does his when it's a double down and he does his counts, and he's very animated when he's doing certain things. But again, it's unique, it's, you know, his own thing. And again, just looking at certain like nuances that are just, you know, things that I can kind of pick up, and more when you get into knowing how to work it and what like a referee's job is, you start to see it more. So like I'll notice wee things like where, especially after like say there's a big spot and there's a kind of things that referees will do to check on the guys and make sure, and you see them do it. You're more aware of it because you're in the know, rather than like it's quite subtly done if you don't know. If that makes sense.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Dennis had a wee gripe about that guy as well, because he was a bit lax with rules that wasn't established, and it was a bit weird. But I was thinking of bald head referees that made everything about themselves. I just thought of Slick Johnson from TNA, who would be the only referee in shorts. He'd have like these what are they called? They're not known like the 90s footballers would have these really short shorts, that kind of thing.
Oh, the biker ones, yeah.
They were not nice. It wasn't a sight that you wanted to see often, but yeah, there has been times where referees, to try and make it a little bit more about themselves as a character. I mean, for the Mick Foley thing, I suppose if he was a perfect referee, then what's the point of you guys if a wrestler can do it, you know?
Yeah.
So even though it was, I mean, even me as a non-referee looking at it going, oh, Mick, move that way. It made sense a little bit, I suppose, in the whole story thing. Hopefully that's how he kind of rationalised it when he was starting about right in front of the camera. So I've got another one from Dennis, of course, the last one. When it comes to rules, if you could change or get rid of one rule, what would it be and why?
That's a good question. If I could change one or get rid of one, I just don't know. That's a really good question. I would say, it's interesting, obviously, doing, you know, traditional wrestling matches that we'll do like at Discovery or Reckless, with things like DQs and countouts, and then, you know, going to work at ICW where they don't have DQs and countouts and stuff. So it's, if I had to kind of pick, I would say, because obviously DQs matter, but I would say countouts. I don't really see, like, I think if they abolished countouts, I don't think it would make an impact. Like, I don't think it would make any difference if they got rid of a countout, because, you know, guy can go out and brawl around the barriers and crowds and stuff.
Would you throw it more as Japan? It's a 20 count instead, which gives you a little bit more of, it can be there, but it gives you a bit more leeway to slow it down.
It slows it down, but then at the same time, I just think, like, I don't know. It's even as a fan watching wrestling, I've never ever thought there's been any purpose to a count out. I don't know why. I think, you know, again, you're kind of taught that, like, sometimes you'll if, you know, the match maybe spills out in the crowd or will go elsewhere, like the ref, you see a lot of referees go with them, so like they're not even counting. So I think it's one of these ones that if it was to go, it wouldn't be lost. And to stand in the ring and do a 20 count, I think would be, yeah, I wouldn't like that. I don't think I would like that. It's bad enough at 10. But and then you get the ones where the guys will do that roll in, roll out thing to break it, and it just like I've seen myself. Yeah, on you know, shows back and that, where someone will do it and I'm just like, oh, and it's like, I know I've got to start that again. And then you'll get guys who'll do it deliberately to kind of mess with you. So, yeah, I think if there was one that I could get rid of, I would say get rid of the countouts, because I don't really see what the purpose would be. I get there is a point to it, but then I don't think it'd be a loss if it was to go.
How much do you enjoy when the crowd counts one number ahead of you when you're doing count outs?
I hate it because I get lost sometimes, and it's like it'll be that way where I'm you're trying to do it to a time, you're trying to time it properly and not be too fast, and then when they start doing that, and then I'm thinking, oh, I'm at seven, I'm at six, what happened there? And then yeah. I don't like it. And I don't have a problem with it actually, because if I say I don't like it, they're going to start doing it. So yeah, I'm not, it's fine. It's all right, honest.
So yeah, anyone listening, do not count one number ahead.
Please don't. Count, no. Don't. It messes with me and I don't like it, and you'll see me doing it. So don't, yeah.
So but your in-ring career wasn't over though. You're doing all the refereeing it at Reckless, ICW, Disco, and of course Rock and Wrestle with Ryback. You made a couple appearances in the Reckless Rumble as well. So when you're three. Approached, what was it, three now?
I think it's three. I've done three, yeah.
Sure. That's because when I was listening to Stevens one, it was 2019. So you must have appeared in 2020 as well. That was it, or before the world ended. Who knows? I can't remember.
Yeah,
but. Yeah, so is that enough for you as your little taste of in-ring stuff to keep that dream a little bit alive, and just, but that's enough, your Rumble appearances?
It's fun. The first time I done it was more an award from the guys at Reckless to say, you know, you've done really well, and we're going to reward you for going into the Rumble. And again, like you say, having that week in a moment, but oh, I was nervous going into that, but it was fun. The second one I done, we had like a funny wee spot with myself and Sean McLaughlin, where it was we built it as like a Rock Hogan standoff, where we backed into each other and they kind of slow turn around, and then kind of are they gonna go, and then the bloody 9-9 chucked us out, which yeah, and then the last one I done, where I think it was another referee we had on the show, and I think I stunned him in the ring, and then threw him out and had a bit. But it's, you know, yeah, it is enough, but never say never. Never say never.
I mean, Sean wrestled a match in Discovery.
Yeah, it's something that has been spoken about, that would I be interested in doing that, or would that be something that I would do? And like seeing what Sean done was really cool, and I think there is that. I mean, I'm going to be 40 next month, so you know, hopefully next year, maybe if it be Reckless. I've spoke with Alan at Discovery and said, you know, it was a cool thing with Sean, and if it was the right kind of maybe program, or you know, we could work some kind of angle or something, I'd be up for that. I've got myself in a lot better shape, fitness wise as well, and yeah, I think maybe just to have that kind of wee moment, like in a tag match or a six man or something, would be quite smart and quite cool to do. So
I'll float an idea by you then. So it's a year build up. yourself and Sean, zombie lumberjack match, and for the following year, then you could be the zombie referee, or Sean could be the zombie referee. You know, that's just...
Could work, yeah.
So there's a zombie referee recently on NXT, which is weird, but they explained it.
See that.
He was Canadian. Yeah. Didn't understand, but I was like, okay, I'll go with it. I'll just run with that. That's fine. But no, there you go, Alan. If you're listening to this or watching this, there you go. Zombie lumberjack match next year. Sean McLaughlin versus Chris Quinn.
Oh, that was it. Twitter light. If that happens, yeah.
I'll be the first one to go, that was my idea.
Yeah. I'll credit you for it.
There's one last question that we've got here, and then I've got some little bits and pieces. But Stephen Louch, of course, who we've mentioned many a times, he doesn't do Tackle the Draw anymore, but it's still a very good bit of material to go back and get information from, which is what I did here. If you could only keep one hashtag for your post, which one would it be?
Yeah, I like a hashtag and a post. If I could only keep one, how many do I have? I've got quite a lot. A lot of the things I do put up, I take a lot of inspiration for guys like The Rock and DDP. I'm very much about, you know, positivity and, you know, putting out a positive message. He's a dick. I like Lynch. You always get a good bit of back and forth with him. If I had to keep
going. Well, I mean, you were part of the most controversial match in Reckless Ten history, so he's always going to have a bit of a.
Oh, yeah. This is the one, because it was, do you know, that was actually my second show in Clubman in Town Hall. And yeah, apparently it was my fault that DCT lost his UK title because I was the referee and I didn't see something. And Louch never forgave me for that. Chase greatness, that's the one I'll keep, because you just always strive to be the best you can.
Excellent. Have you got a bottle of Terra Mana, just out of curiosity?
Do I have a bottle?
Yeah.
I've got that much left in a bottle, and I think it's my second or third bottle. It's my 40th birthday in about 4 or 5 weeks time, so I'm kind of hoping that someone gets me one, the girlfriend or my mum and dad or someone. But I've dropped enough hints anyway. But it's good stuff. I do like it. Not just because it's The Rock's one. I got ripped from my brother about that. He said, you know, would you still like that if it wasn't The Rock's? And it is actually like a very nice, smooth tequila. That is good.
That's what I was going to ask, because me and tequila do not have a good relationship. If I have maybe two or three, I am dead. That's pretty much it. So I'm always curious. I've always wanted to get a bottle for that exact reason, because it's The Rock's. So I want to get one and put on my wife's little dolly thing that she has with all the other alcohol, with my crystal head, vodka and stuff like that.
Yeah.
I'm a more vodka kind of guy.
The best way to describe it is, like, I mean, I was like yourself. I was never really a big tequila fan through many bad times with tequila. We'll just leave it at that. I won't go into detail. But it's like if you liken it to, say, like a vodka, you know, if you drink a standard, like Grant's vodka or Smirnoff vodka, you know, as your regular, and it's okay. But then if you then, you know, get yourself like a bottle of Grey Goose, which is more expensive, a finer, you know, quality vodka, you can see the difference in them. And that's the best way I can describe it, because I can drink tequila, but not like, I'm not really into the kind of, the you know, the salt and the lime and the slamming and stuff like that. I can do shots of it, but like I like the sipping one, and the Terra Mana is a sipping smooth tequila, and it's a lot nicer to kind of just, you know, drink over ice or drink straight, but not necessarily for shots, if you know what I mean.
And this is the Terra Mana ad that I'm going to try and clip and see if The Rock will retweet it. He does like retweet Terra Mana ads, so
I'll be trying.
We'll try and get that done, but no. In the case of buying stuff because of who owns it, I think that's why we have a bottle of aviation gin. Although I had it, and it's one of the few times I've liked gin. So there you go, Ryan Reynolds. There's one for you as well.
there's one for him. Yeah.
Who else? We've got was it Los Hombres, the Breaking Bad one. There you go. Advertise all the celebrity.
Those are all the one.
So we've got a couple of questions that we like to ask people, and then we'll go back to the wrestling for a little bit. We ask everyone, what's your favourite dinosaur?
Initially I was going to say T-Rex, but I do love the Raptors. I love the Raptors. Big Jurassic Park fan. I remember going to see that when I was, about 11, 12 years old. 1993, I remember going to see that. That's how old that is. I couldn't believe it was a PG. Going to the cinema, I went to the cinema to see it with mum and dad, and I could not believe it was a PG. But in that, I would say T-Rex was always my favourite. But then as Jurassic World and that came out, with Blue, the Raptor, I like the Raptors.
Fair enough. I recently put out a list of my top 100 dinosaurs. It was very controversial. because I had Charizard in the top 10, but it was a whole thing. Nobody really picked up at number 97 was Internet Explorer. And everyone, and nobody picked, that was the one everyone accepted, but not Charizard being in the top 10. That's a fine choice. It's a classic. And our question we ask everyone is, what would win in a fight, two sheep or one cow?
Two sheep, 100%. I've never seen angry. What, is that a cow or a bull?
Cow. Right. This is the question. It's two sheep versus one cow. If you want to add any caveats or any additional rules, if it's a Highland cow, if it's steroid induced sheep, I don't mind. You use your imagination. Go wild.
I would say, I mean, I've never seen an angry cow. Well, apart from my ex-wife. But I have seen, like, when I've done, like, my hill walks and stuff, that you do see sheep that, you know, they look as if, you know, are you going to try and steal their lambs and that? And they can be quite, you know, aggressive looking. So I would have to say two sheep every time.
I love this question. The more I ask it, the more people put thought into it, which it's when you put the question on the surface, it's a stupid question. But it's one, because I've spoken to everyone for like an hour and they're like, oh, I'm really into speaking. Oh, two sheep, one cow. Yeah, I'll just think about this really hard. Back to the wrestling, though. I think that's that silly shenanigans, stupid question, by the way. Of matches that you've had then, so of course you've refereed Ryback, which I'm sure was an experience up in Inverness, would have been the last Rock and Wrestle show, I think it was, before SWA took it over. I missed it, and because I'm in Elgin, so I'm only like an hour away from Inverness, so it should have been one I could have got to, but didn't, even though it's Ryback. So you've refereed that, you've refereed matches with Bram, Sugar Dunkerton. Who's been your particular favourite to referee, whether it's a big name or an imported name or just a regular Joe in Scottish wrestling or UK wrestling?
Joe, there's so many, and it's actually really nice now where there's so many guys that I've even now formed friendships with, working with. I'd say, you know, some of my favourites to work with, like Divers is one of my highlights, and he's a good mate as well, but they have this wee thing about trying to break me in the ring by you know, whispering still game quotes in my ear and stuff like that, and try to make me laugh. Andy Wilde, I love working with. DCT, like, I mean, there's so many. BT Gunn, I've worked with a number of times, and, you know, I getting to, you know, work with guys like that on the regular at ICW, and then when they come and do Discovery, Reckless, and other places. I'd say getting to go and do Discovery and then getting to do ICW was just, you know, getting to work with so much more names that I'd be watching as a fan. Because even before I was doing, like, ICW, I'd be still going to ICW shows, because deep down, I think everyone, we are all fans at the end of the day. So getting to work with some of these guys that, you know, are entertaining, it's a privilege, it is. And there's nobody that I could say, you know, I don't like working with. But I've just been fortunate enough to work with some really, really top guys and guys who've went on to, like, WWE and doing stuff. Joe Coffey was always a great one to work with at Discovery. Loved working with him. And again, some of the one of my best standout matches, I think, was Joe and Andy Wilde. And it was just hard hitting, back and forth. And I think it might have been that one that I can remember. There was the end of it where I was just I was knackered. So I don't know how they felt, but I was absolutely burst, because it was back and forth, hard hitting drama. Everything, just, it was one of those ones I came at the end of it, and I was just like, I think even when I hit the three count, I was there on my knees and I was like, oh, thank God that's over, because it was again an absolute joy to call.
You mentioned a lot of those names there. Of course, you refereed for ICW during the no crowd era, which was just about a year of matches going out, shows going out with no crowds. What was it like? I mean, for you, I suppose it'd be a little bit different because you're there to call the match itself. You're not so much there for the crowd to be in tune with. But what was it like refereeing in front of nobody? Was it like going back to the training days?
It was strange because obviously my goal initially like was to get to ICW, and then I got a spot at the Fight Club in the November 2019. And I always remember this where it was I was nervous as hell, and again, you know, kind of the ICW crowd, you know, can be more vocal, but you know, they were absolutely brilliant, and they are, they're electric as well. And I always remember like going out, I was nervous going out that show, and just right before I went out, it was Mark Dallas just basically put his hand on my shoulder and said, "Go and enjoy yourself, welcome to ICW." And it was like, it meant a lot, and then literally got Fear and Loathing the following week. And then it was always just that way where I was going to, you know, fill in if any of the two guys there, like Sean or Thomas, couldn't do it. And then when we done, I got called for, it was the Bard show, which was the All the Ones in the Steel Cage, which we filmed last, I think it was December. And it was just weird. Wearing a mask in the ring, I did not like. Although it had some uses, when, you know, if something made me laugh, you couldn't see. But the no crowd, it was just eerily silent. And again, like a lot of the reactions and the energy you feed off for the crowd. And even as a referee, it's just, you look for all those kind of wee moments where, you know, it could be a near fall, it could be stuff going on, and it was just oddly silent, and you could hear every step, every bump, everything, and just die. Strange. It was so glad to welcome back crowds. It was different, and it was fun in the sense of getting to do more ICW work, obviously behind the closed door tapings and stuff, but just almost very studio like in a way, rather than like a live show. But again, grateful for the opportunity and just to get back in, because I mean I hadn't refereed for, I think when I done, that was 2019, and when I done ICW and then I done Fear and Loathing literally the next week, where like Dallas gave me the book in there, which I was not expected, and then I hurt my back badly, slipped two discs in my back, and then I was out for about over Christmas and New Year, till about, I think it was like the late January, February time. It was a good three months or so. And I came back, and I think I think it was a Discovery show and then a Reckless, and then the pandemic hit. So I'd missed the end of year Discovery show in the December, and then I'd missed a couple of Reckless shows, and then I'd missed something else. Came back, done literally two shows, piled on the weight, wasn't even feeling good about myself, and then the pandemic hit and it all stopped. So then it was literally from, I think, the January right through to the December, I hadn't refereed at all. Whereas I know some shows were still going on up until like March time, but that's when we started getting things cancelled. So then getting back in the ring, and it's like, can I remember how to do this properly, you know? And then there's no, so on one hand there was no nervousness of it, like, you know, messing up in front of a crowd, but at the same time it was like, you know, this stuff's getting recorded for WWE Network, you know, so you can't muck up. And then, like they say, just like riding a bike, you know, once you get back in, start to do it and get back on it, and it was fine. But definitely a strange feeling, no crowd, but then, you know, couldn't wait for them to come back.
When you found out that you were going to be on the WWE Network, or when you were getting nice to be booking, I think at that point they were already on the network, how many people have you sent links to and shown screenshots of you on the WWE Network? So this is the same network as The Rock, as Hulk Hogan. You can, I mean, I don't think you can search for referees' names, but you're still there. You're still on the same network as all them. So yeah, how many people did you tell? Was just shouting from the rooftops?
It was a cool thing, because it was like, again, you know, friends growing up, two of my closest mates who were all, you know, wrestling fans. And it's that way where certain friends you maybe meet, a couple of good mates, one who I met through work, and it's one of those weird moments, and you've probably done it yourself, where like you maybe say something or you'll something will get said, and it may be wrestling related, and then someone else just kind of goes, and it's like, oh, wrestling friend. You know, it's like the record is like, do you watch wrestling? Or do you watch wrestling? Right, and then it goes to that. So people like that who could really kind of appreciate it and then know what like how big a deal it is and how cool it was to actually be on it. Told some people in my work and that, and they're like, oh, what's that? And it's like, oh, it's only a worldwide platform, you know, streamed all over the world, you know, I'm not saying nothing about that, but it's something, again, it's just something I never ever thought could be possible, and it's just something, again, that I don't let my daughter watch a lot of ICW stuff, but then again, a lot of the more stuff that's on the network isn't, there's not as much, you know, violent and swearing and stuff, so she gets to see me, and she actually says a lot more to our wee friends and people and thought, oh, my daddy's on the telly and on this and that, and you know, again, she's no what the kind of concept it where she she's a bigger Rock fan than I am, and you know, she'll say, does The Rock see you refereeing? And I was like, well, he's got the network, so if he looks up ICW stuff, then maybe I. So that's quite weird. And then she says, oh, maybe you could referee The Rock's match. And I'm like, no. Trying to explain that side to her, it's like, you know, no, that's not going to happen. You know, I don't think they're going to pick me up for Scotland and take me to a WrestleMania main event, you know. So.
Well, that actually leads perfectly onto the kind of question that we're going to kind of wrap up on, then do the social media stuff like that. If you had the choice, dream match, or if you're so inclined, where and when, but dream match, who would you want to referee? It could be a singles match, could be multi-man, TLC, could be anything to your heart's content. What would you referee?
Now, obviously, now it can't be like anyone for the past. I would say that to probably be at a WrestleMania or a Raw or a big WWE pay-per-view, you know, one of the big ones like a SummerSlam or mainly WrestleMania, and probably somebody like Randy Orton and AJ Styles, I would say. I've watched, obviously, Randy Orton fold his career. AJ Styles, another one I popped for when he showed up in WWE, because I'd seen obviously his TNA stuff, and then, you know, knew he went to Japan and done all that, and it was always one of those ones that probably wasn't meant to get to WWE, and then you always thought if he did get there, would they get, you know, would they misuse him and that, and the fact is he's just excelled. I think to work with somebody like that, somebody like a Randy Orton, on a big stage, and I mean, doing Fear and Loathing, it was like one of the biggest crowds I've ever worked in front of, and it was an absolute buzz. And I'm very envious of like Sean and Thomas who got to do the Hydro when IKW ran that. But to maybe do something when you see like WrestleManias, when they do these stadiums, you know, where, you know, 70,000-80,000 people, must be insane, incredible to do. So I would say probably like a Randy Orton, AJ Styles, even Drew McIntyre, something like that, in a big stadium at a Mania would probably be the ultimate dream. I don't think The Rock's going to come back and do any more matches. He might get that one with Roman, but yeah, I can't see me getting that.
so you take the triple threat, Orton, Styles, Drew, referee that, go backstage, and The Rock's there with a wee shot of Terramana waiting for you. That would be the dream.
That would be the dream. That is the dream, yes.
Perfect. Well, thanks for taking the time to speak to me today. Of course, by the time this goes out, Fear and Loathing will only be, I don't know, 3 weeks away, something like that. Not that long to go. I think it's an hour two-nighter. But where can people find you on social media if they want to ask more refereeing questions or just want to find out more about yourself?
Yeah, so I'm on all the mainly big social media ones. Instagram is Chris7Quinn7. Facebook is Chris Quinn, and Twitter, I don't use a lot of Twitter. I started using it a bit more, but it's just Chris7Quinn on Twitter, at Chris7Quinn. Again, I'm on most of them, but I try and limit a lot of time on posting a lot of stuff on social media, like Twitter especially. I just don't really use it as much. But Instagram, I like to kind of share my referee stuff, share my family stuff, share my workout stuff, my gym stuff and that, as you've probably seen on my Instagram a lot.
Get all your hashtags in. Excellent. Perfect. Thanks very much for joining me today.
No, thanks, mate. Appreciate being on and, yeah, look forward to looking for it going out as well. Appreciate the invite as well.